my heart, love that will not part, love God's love.
The book of Judges contrasts the unyielding fidelity of God with the utter faithlessness of his people. Joshua had defeated all the major Canaanite armies and divided the land by tribal allotment. When Joshua died, there was no central government to replace his leadership. Instead, each tribe was commissioned by Joshua to fulfill the command of God by driving all the remaining Canaanites out of their territory and serving the Lord faithfully. The book of Judges opens with some tribes trying to fulfill that commission and others failing miserably, allowing the Canaanites to remain in the land. The pagans, as Joshua, Moses, and the Lord predicted, eventually influenced Israel to worship their idols, setting up what would become the sin cycle of generational rebellion that was the hallmark of Judges. The cycle included four steps. Number one, Israel apostatized by worshiping false gods. Number two, God allowed his people to be oppressed by some heathen tribe. Number three, Israel would cry out for deliverance after coming to their senses. And number four, God would raise up a judge to deliver the people by fighting off the oppressors. Now, judges were generally military commanders, despite the name judge. Some of them ruled and some settled disputes, like Deborah, but most of them were simply known for their skill as warriors. Edward Young affirms this understanding, quote, "During this period, the rulers of the people were termed judges. They were not, however, merely civil magistrates who administered justice and adjudicated disputes. Primarily, they were deliverers, endued with the power of the Spirit of God, who were called upon to deliver and to govern the people in times of declension and oppression." Many scholars, like Young, believe that the book of Judges was written to demonstrate the people's need for a strong central government led by a righteous monarch, a king. Daniel Block explains this view, quote, "Impressed by the refrain, 'There was no king in Israel,' which appears four times in the last five chapters, scholars have often interpreted the book of Judges as an apologetic for the monarchy in Israel. The chaos reflected in the narratives demonstrates the need for a centralized royal constitution." However, I suggest a different interpretation for that infamous refrain, "In those days there was no king in Israel, and everyone did what was right in his own eyes," as recorded in places like Judges 17 and verse 6. Would a monarchy really improve the fidelity and moral character of Israel? Sometimes, yes, when great and noble men like David, Hezekiah, or Josiah were in charge. But the overwhelming majority of Israel's kings were wicked, and they led the people into apostasy and idolatry, similar to what was being practiced during this era of the judges. Who was really supposed to be Israel's righteous king? The answer is the Lord God of heaven and earth. In fact, Moses sang at the end of the book of Deuteronomy about how the people had made the Lord their king and ruler back at Mount Sinai. In Deuteronomy 33, verses 3 through 5, we read these words, "Yes, he loved his people. All his holy ones were in his hand, so they followed in your steps, receiving direction from you when Moses commanded us a law as a possession for the assembly of Jacob. Thus, the Lord became king in Jeshurun. When the heads of the people were gathered, all the tribes of Israel together." Israel's problem was not that they lacked a human monarch. It was that they had rejected God's sovereign rule as enacted through the constitution of the law of Moses. However, in spite of about four centuries of cyclical rebellion, God never abandoned his people. And whenever they were ready to repent and return to him, he was there with open, loving, and accepting arms to joyfully receive them. The College Press NIV commentary gets it just right. Quote, "Judges' purpose is first and foremost theological in nature. The book of Judges intends to do more than merely support David or Josiah as the legitimate monarch of the Hebrews. It promotes Israel as a people struggling in faithfulness to their God. The leadership vacuum that Judges observes is secondary to the negative commentary provided on Israel's abandonment of the commitment to the Lord. This perspective better fits the literary composition techniques used by Judges' author. Many commentators point out Judges' author's use of the cyclical pattern of sin, oppression, repentance, and deliverance as a literary device within the book. This repeated pattern of decline effectively maps the degeneration of a society that abandons the Lord. Judges reminds readers that the Lord is merciful and faithful to his covenant in spite of disobedience. God will always fulfill his end of the arrangement. He is ever ready and eager to bless, forgive, and deliver."